Howdy, y'all. This is Dr. Jeff Jarvis. I have another clinical mail time episode for you. Now, y'all know the concept of these videos is for me to answer your questions. Well, I'm definitely going to be answering a question, but this question comes not from one of y'all, but one of my ER colleagues. So I was in the emergency department yesterday, and I was walking past the radio, and I noticed one of my nurses getting an EMS report. Now, something out of the corner of my eye caught my attention and made me look over there. There was just something abnormal. And when I looked, I saw her getting a rope, tying around her neck, and thinking about how she could kill herself. I was like, "What are you doing, Heather?" And she said, "This report is never going to end, so I figured I should just go ahead and kill myself now." So the question that she had for me is, isn't there a template? Isn't there like a specified section of stuff, information that they're supposed to give us where we can just get to the point and move on? I said, well, you know, as it turns out, there is. So I would like to go over what information we need to include in a radio report. But before I do that, I'd like to give you a demonstration, slightly facetious, but not all that facetious, of how some of these radio reports are received in the emergency department and why I feel the need to go over this so that we can standardize our reporting. Let's take a look at a hypothetical situation that may or may not have occurred in an emergency department recently.
Yeah, the Baylor Scott and White, this is a medic. I wanted to let you know that we're headed on in there with about a 10 to 15 minute ETA with a 43-year-old lady that had a mechanical fall while she was out walking her chihuahua. She fell down. She says that she's kind of complaining of a little bit of left hip, left back pain. Did not hit her head. She did not lose consciousness.
She's complaining that the pain is sharp and radiating down that leg. Vital sign. 127 over 68, heart rate is 72 on the monitor, SpO2 is 98% on nasal cannula 2 liters. We got a 20-gauge IV established into the left AC. I'm giving her about 100 micrograms of fentanyl IV, followed by a dose of ketamine because she was still hurting. She's currently awake, alert, oriented, but a little bit kind of lethargic now after the medications. And again, we have about a 3-minute ETA now depending on traffic. And you got any questions or interventions there, Scott and White Round Rock? Okay.
Well, again, Scott and White Round Rock, do you have any... You got any questions or?
Report received.
Okay. All right. Well, we'll see you in just a little bit then. Williamson County Medic 41. 41 out.
All right. So, do you have an idea after watching that and listening to that wonderful report that may or may not have been Dr. Tobelman? Do you have an idea or a little sympathy for why our nurses may be asking us to get to the point? Now, obviously, we were being a little facetious with that, but not all that often. Really, some of these reports go on and on and on. There is a small piece of information that the nurses need to know to get ready to receive the patient. Otherwise, they have a lot of other things going on. So the request from our hospitals is please get to the point, no extraneous information. Well, wouldn't it be great if we had a form, a template, a list of the important information that we need to give? Well, it turns out we do. So the CAT-RAC has come together. They dealt with all of the receiving facilities in our area, and they've said this is the information that we need to get. So I'm going to go over that now, and we're going to put this up on the screen also just so that we can see what this looks like. We're also going to make small versions of this that we're going to put out to everybody so we can have it on the truck. We can use it in our new employee orientation and our field training so that everybody is on the same page. All right, so start off with your name, medic, unit, and agency. Tell us how old the patient is, what their gender is, what their chief complaint is. If it is an alert, a trauma alert, a STEMI alert, a stroke alert, a septic shock alert, say that. Tell us what their current vital signs are. Tell us any interventions that you have done to the ABC, so life-threatening interventions or life-saving interventions only. If you're not using that IV to do something life-saving, don't mention it. If it's a drug that is not life-saving, don't mention it. And then let us know what the interventions are. Does that make sense? So get to the point. We really want to be short, not long-winded, get to the point, and get out. Now, if it is a STEMI alert, so there are some additional criteria here. If it's a STEMI alert, tell us what the ECG changes are, and be very clear that you are calling a STEMI alert. If it is a stroke alert, let us know the time that the patient was last known well and what the blood glucose level was. If it's trauma, include the mechanism of injury briefly. Brief mechanism. Say whether they have a C-collar on or, heaven forbid, they're on a backboard so that the facility can be prepared to get them off of that evil thing quickly, and whether they're on any anticoagulants. If it is an OB emergency, let us know what the gestational age is, rough estimate, term, 25 weeks, because it turns out that makes a difference. If the patient is over 20 to 22 weeks, most hospitals, that patient is going to be an OB patient rather than an ER patient. If the baby has been delivered, give us a very, very brief summary of what the baby is doing. And then if you happen to know the prenatal physician at that facility, that may be useful. Now, those are the criteria. And the one thing I would like to say about this is more information than I would like y'all to give. It's definitely more information than my nurses want to hear. So why am I asking you to do it? It's because this is the form that was the end result of a process of inclusion where all of the hospitals got together. This is what they agreed on. So this is what I would like to use. So let's get another scenario and see if this time maybe our medic Tobelman can get to the point a little quicker.
Baylor Scott and White, this is Ross and Wilco, Medic 11, calling with the patient report.
This is Tom White, go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. We're en route with a 65-year-old male complaining of chest pain. The EKG is non-diagnostic for STEMI. GCS is 15, heart rate is 65, blood pressure is 165 over 90, respiratory rate is 16, sat in 98% on room air. ETA is 10 minutes.
Report received.
Williamson County Medic 11 clear. Coo-coo-coo-choo!
All right, so that is the end of the clinical mail time. Hopefully, I'm not offending anyone with this. But truly, when you're in a busy emergency department and you're taking time between patients and the 13 million phone calls that we have to take every minute, we want you to get to the point and tell us the information that we need to know and know more. All right. If you have any questions, if you have any comments, let me know. Drop me an email. Thanks a lot, y'all. All right, y'all. So I do want to thank the folks at Baylor Scott & White Round Rock, particularly Heather. And I'd also like to thank Dr. Tobelman for being a...
Oh, hey, there he is! Oh, I love this guy like family!
Oh, it's so good to see you. I've missed you so much.
Awkward.
It's so good. Let me look at you. Oh, you're so cute.